Hey Potters, welcome to episode 252 of CosPod Podcast for all things cosplay. Woohoo! Welcome to summer.
It's weird. It's Texas, and it's Texas, and there's global warming, so it's kind of strange. It's like it's a good time to craft if you need to do outdoorsy stuff, but also not a good time to craft because of all of the crappy weather and the fact that we get like a thunderstorm every other day, and then there's high winds, and then there's all the pollen
and tornadoes,
and
yeah, the news for
and hail. But,
let's start off with Happy Easter and a blessed Good Friday to those who celebrate.
There we go.
You know, if you need to take some time off from working on cosplay to celebrate, to observe, please do. We wish you a most blessed holiday. For those that don't celebrate, we're going to talk about cosplay.
Maybe make an Easter-inspired cosplay.
Well, there are plenty of people who do the whole fursuit thing.
Yeah.
Easter, because, you know, Easter rabbits, chicks, that sort of thing.
And I've seen a bunch of people who've done, like, themed versions of characters. Like, they'll do Sailor Moon, but then they'll all have, like, cute Easter dresses or something like that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so
they'll
why not?
The whole bunny headband thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's always fun. I like those variations.
Yes. And for working on cosplay in Texas, you basically get, like, 1 or 2 hour windows periodically when you can work on cosplay. When it's not either freezing cold, burning hot, or inclement weather.
Tornado.
Which will encompass all of the other things, like torrential rains, hail, downburst winds, occasional tornadoes, pollen storms.
It's fine. As Tamlin has posted, this is first summer, then we're going to have spring again, and then there will be second summer. Not quite as enjoyable as second breakfast.
Second breakfast is always enjoyable.
It is. However, when it comes to weather, not so much.
But second cosplay, always a good idea.
There we go. Good segue.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We're professionals.
Since I don't have very much, I will show you what I do have. Amber has been practicing embroidery, which...
That looks really nice. No, that looks really good. It's very clear.
I ended up getting from the bookstore clearance section a book of Celtic designs.
Oh, that's great.
And it has all sorts of not only the designs, but traceable patterns.
Oh, cool.
So I sat here and painstakingly, in fact, where's my... Okay, I will show you. My painstaking pattern that I made, because you know I love doing these things with my puffy paint embroidery, so I made another one.
Of course you
Twice
did.
I had to trace this. Once on paper, because paper is the only thing thin enough for me to trace on. And then I had to cut it out, just like this, and then I had to trace it into a more stiff material. Because for anyone who's ever worked with commercial patterns right out of the envelope, you know that the tissue paper slides everywhere. And it wrinkles, it folds when you don't need it to, it won't stay in place. Hate working with tissue paper. Well, I will tell you that notebook paper is the exact same way.
Mm-hmm.
And so I refuse to use it for patterns. I'll use it to make the initial shape, but then I have to put it on something stiffer like cardstock or poster board or tag board. Take your pick. Mm-hmm. But I have to draw it into something more stiff so I can actually use it as pattern, which is why I did this. So this was my pattern piece, and then you can see the one I have in progress. Like all of the things I do, I trace it in pen first.
Cringe. I was afraid to ask, and I was like, I know she's going to say pen.
Of course I did. Well, given the color of the fabric, how dark this is.
I don't care.
I either have to go really dark, or I have to go really light to be able to see it. And I don't have anything light that would actually stay on here that I can wash off. So I used pen because that's what I got. My other option was to use a makeup pencil.
Actually,
my embroidery has covered every millimeter of the pen.
But that's not the point. My heart hurts.
Yes, I know. It'll come off in the wash.
Uh-huh.
But I have learned, because this is a training experience for Amber, that embroidery is difficult, not because of like actually the physical act of pushing the needle and thread through, you know, fabric. It's difficult because you have to make all of the stitches the exact same size.
Yeah.
And you have to do that with a pattern that wasn't necessarily made with stitches in mind. So you may not get that exact number of stitches as you're trying to make them all even. Mm-hmm. You may get like a half stitch here and there. Or even tinier stitch, like a seed stitch, to basically make it fit in the design. And making them all the same size without a machine is incredibly difficult. That's the hard part I have learned about embroidery, is being even-handed about it. I can do even-handed all day with puff paint. Doing it with a needle and thread is hard, yo.
It's really challenging. People don't give hand embroidery enough credit because they think, oh, it's just a bunch of stitches that you do back and forth and this and this. It's like, no, to keep the stitches consistent in size and consistency, and even with the thread texture too. That's the other thing. Yes. It is so easy with embroidery for thread to knot. And if you're not careful, not careful, it can just be a tremendous pain in the rear.
Yes.
It is
and
very difficult.
And my thread has knotted several times, mm-hmm. one of which was almost so bad that I had to cut it off and start over.
Yep.
But I thankfully managed to save it. But you can see on the back, you can see how neat, this is the back, this is not the front. This is how neat it has to look. Like you have
to really
look
nice.
To make sure, you have to look and make sure that all of the stitches, because you're back stitching the whole thing, are the same distance from each other. And I've had to pull out stitches a few times because I wasn't happy with it.
Yep.
Because when you do this, you only really get one shot because you've poked a hole in the fabric and the hole stays, even if you take the needle out of it. So I am definitely learning a lot in the process of doing this. So, yeah, the reason I am practicing embroidery is because I would like to embroider the Athena dress that I am in the process of making, because I can't find lace that has any sort of design that I want.
Mm.
Even if I were to piece it together to make custom lace,
right?
I have to have the right components. All the laces I've looked at, none of them like have what I'm looking for. So what I need to do next is to go get out my sketchbook, which is about 10 feet from me that way, and sketch out kind of a design that I want to embroider that's not too complicated, because I'm not good at this yet. Remember, kids, even though you've cosplayed for a long time, you won't be good at everything.
It takes time to learn.
There are still skills you will have to learn when you are a cosplayer. And I'm having to teach myself this new thing and go through kind of all the trials and tribulations that you go through when you're learning things, making mistakes and such. But that's why I'm doing it on test pieces of scrap, which I can use these for something else, like coasters or something later on. So they're not waste. But I'm practicing on something that's not the original. Just like you wouldn't cut into fabric the first time you trace over it. You know, you measure twice, cut once. I'm doing kind of the same thing while I figure out what design I want to embroider on it. And also, I have learned that the kind of thread that you use makes a huge difference.
World of difference.
The kind of needle that you use. And there are specific needles for embroidery, and they are labeled as such. You can go and buy embroidery needles. There are many different kinds of hand needles, and you'll see that they're all labeled differently. You want the ones that are for embroidery, and there's a good reason for that, I have learned.
It's a very good reason for that. I mean, technically, yes, you can embroider with any needle. However, particularly with the embroidery needle, it makes it so the pinhole is super, 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 super tiny. So you have the least amount of holes and gappage in your fabric, so you can do a lot more ornate work.
And the needle is super sharp.
Oh, yeah,
it is. So it slides through the fabric more easily. But that
also
means you can easily, you know, stitch yourself in mistake.
Wear a thimble.
So, be very careful. And also having a needle threader.
Yes. Really helpful.
Is your best friend when you're working with needles that have very, very small eyes.
Yes, the eyes are really tiny on those suckers.
Yeah. Sometimes it's been hard for me to get the thread through it.
Yes.
And sometimes even this doesn't help.
Mm-hmm. It's a challenge.
But I do what I can. And if you have to switch to a different needle, you can totally do that.
Oh, yeah.
But that is one thing. And then the second thing, as I reach across myself here.
Is it the chasm that is your desk?
Well, there's only so much room whenever you have foam, which is the other thing I did. So I went and acquired more foam because this guy, remember how I told you guys last time that the foam cracked? Like, you may not even be able to see it, but you can see how it bends at 30 degrees.
Oh, yeah, you can see it.
Or 90 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
Foam should not do this. This should be a very even circle if I were to bend this all the way around, which is originally what it did. It bent in a very perfect 360-degree circle when I first made this.
Mm-hmm.
But now you can see the hard corners, and that's what I was talking about last time with the hex flex. My suspicion is because this has been sitting around for a couple of years since pandemic, that hard Texas freeze we had, the monster freeze that hurt a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
My suspicion is it impacted the Hexflex.
I was about to say, were you one of the homes that was without power for a bit?
Yes, I was without power for extended periods of time. It was 37 degrees in my apartment.
That would do it then. Yeah, that's, I mean, it's cold enough to kind of cause some warpage and damage. I know that happened to one of my only armor pieces that I have left. I'm having, at some point I'll have to remake it, but I just don't have the mental strength to do it because the freeze killed it. Because I was without power for nearly an entire week.
Right. I was without power for about 3 days.
Yeah.
And so I need to actually go through all the rest of my cosplay.
And double check.
It has armor and double check it.
Yeah.
The Lena armor should be okay because none of that was ever sealed.
Mm.
It was raw foam and it was covered in fabric. That was before they had Hexflex.
Smart. So that should be fine.
That armor and my Umi armor, which was made the same way. It was fabric covered foam, never sealed. Those two should be okay. Presea, I need to check because I think that one may have been sealed. I think that's the only one besides any of my Ren Fair costumes that I need to check. And my Athena corset was fabric covered. It was never sealed either. Only the decor that went with it was sealed.
Okay.
But I lost all of the Athena decor.
Mm.
All of it is like this.
Gotcha.
So the bracelets I have to redo, the necklace I have to redo, and all of the accessory pieces, the core, the raised pieces that go on the corset, I have to redo all of those too.
Mm.
So that's why I got a package of foam. This stuff is expensive, by the way. Not like everything nowadays isn't expensive.
Sure.
But getting a simple 12-pack of foam is very expensive comparatively. So I will have to go through and find my patterns again because I do still have them. I keep all of my patterns until I retire the costume. So I have them. I need to go get them so I can start tracing onto foam. And then I need to figure out how I will protect my cosplay pieces from the next hard freeze because I am positive we will be doing this again.
Yep.
In the future.
And your guess would be as good as mine when it comes to things like that. I didn't even consider the freeze, but that since you mentioned it, it's like, oh, yeah.
It's the only thing I can think of.
Yeah, because extreme heat will warp foam in the weirdest ways, and extreme cold will do
actually,
the same thing.
Heat would have been better.
Yeah, heat would have been better for that.
Heat causes foam to become very flexible.
It becomes very pliable, so yeah.
And the gems would have fallen off.
Yeah.
If there was extreme heat, because these are glued on with glue that will basically come unbonded with high heat.
Mm.
That's fine. I can just glue the gems back on.
I know.
But I can't uncrack foam.
Exactly. It had to have been the cold. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. So I'm going to have to check all the rest of my cosplays.
Yeah. I should probably do the same now.
And I feel bad because this turned out so well and I was so happy with the new design from the art book version of her dress. But no, I'm going to salvage all the gems. At least I can do that.
Right.
Even if I have to toss all the foam out.
But it means also that this next pair that you make will be even better. Since you did so well on this, the next pair was going to be even better.
Well, we shall see.
It will be.
Needless to say, I have some thinking to do whether or not I'm going to seal it with Hexflex again.
I mean, the cold thing was kind of, you know, unexpected. So
it was, and you would think that it's kind of a once in a lifetime experience, or what do they call it? Once in a generation experience.
That's our entire generation.
We've had two very cold snaps in the last 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
For the first one, we went down to 2 degrees, Fahrenheit. The second one, we were down to 8 degrees Fahrenheit. So, makers of Hexflex, please make your product that will go down to 2 and 8 degrees Fahrenheit so that cosplayers can use it and, you know, not lose our costumes.
Right.
So that's been my cosplay update.
I'm going to go back to the embroidery really quick because I'm very interested in this now. With your test run, are you just doing the outline or are you planning to teach yourself how to do the fill-in techniques?
Both.
Both? Okay.
So I'm practicing the backstitch first so that I can get used to getting my stitches very even first.
Good.
Since I'm still having trouble with that, because when you use the other embroidery techniques, you also still have to have stitches that are equal.
Yes. And a lot of the same ones start with the base of the backstitch. So if you know the backstitch right. and you can do it well, you can build up from the others.
Right. And the next stitch I want to try, I think they call it a leaf stitch.
Yes. That's a great one.
It's like herringbone, basically.
Yeah.
And that's supposed to be one of the easier ones.
Very much so. Good for filling
in. That's the next one I'm going to try.
Cool.
Because that would be the one I would use on her dress, depending on the kind of pattern. Because I know I want it. They call it Greco-Roman. I wish I had the fabric or the ribbon out. But anytime you see Roman costumes around mm-hmm. Halloween, all of them use this trim.
It's the same trim.
It's the one that has the very boxy spiral.
So boxy.
Type.
Yeah. It's like you got an L, you got a box, and you have an S.
Well, not that. It's the one that kind of goes up, over, done.
It's like over, done. Very weird Tetris blocks, but there's nothing in the middle of them.
They're like stylized L's.
Yes.
But that's the kind of thing I want to do on the bottom of her dress, but I want to have some design that can go above the boxes that I would fill in.
Okay.
I just haven't figured out what yet. I even actually considered just embroidering the constellations on there.
Ooh.
Because it's the 12 houses of the Zodiac. It's Knights
that's
of the Zodiac.
That's cool.
It's the name of the series. So I thought about doing that.
That would be
we'll
cool.
See. It would look a little helter-skelter because some of the constellations are fuller than others.
Well, I mean, it's constellations, you know.
Plus, the question is, would anybody actually recognize them as the constellations?
I'm sure.
As opposed to, like, something else.
I'm sure some people would.
Fans of the show probably would. We'll see. I'm still thinking about it. I'm still trying to figure out, like, sketches in my head before I put them on paper.
I'm very excited for you to learn this new skill.
It's figuratively and literally been painful.
Yes.
Sometimes.
It is a challenging skill to master because it seems so simple. It's just, you know, needle, thread, fabric, and you just repeat it a lot of times.
Right.
And there is a point when you're learning that you just go into autopilot because you've done it so many times that you just kind of already know what the stitch length is going to be. That you're just going to be like, poke, poke, poke. And then you can just start watching something on YouTube or Netflix or whatever and just while you're going. That's the fun part.
Sometimes even just a fraction of an inch off and you see it.
You see
in the
it.
Fabric.
It's just like, ah.
And it's like, nope, because I've tried going on autopilot. When I get momentum going,
you'll get
and then
there.
I go on autopilot, and then it gets off by like literally, it's like a thread over from where it should be, and it just irks me so much because it's really hard to take those stitches out. Because normally, the way that people will thread a needle, I have the thread I've been working with actually, you'll thread a needle like this to where you have a tail. So I have a tail hanging off right here so that you guys can see that. I have just a short tail hanging off, and then I have the rest of the body of the thread. So if I want to pull that thread out, I can just pull it off the needle, and I can just put the needle back on when I'm done. Well, the way I thread my needle is to double up, and the knot's down here. So I can't remove the needle because it's tied at both ends. So if I mess up, I have to cut the thread, which then leaves me with half a strand. Half a strand is not much when you're doing embroidery. It runs out very quickly.
When it comes to embroidery, doing it where you have to double up is pretty common because so many of the stitches require you to slip between the thread. So that's pretty normal, unfortunately.
Yes. It also means I can't screw up very often.
Nope. I need to get Amber a tub of beeswax.
So I'll sit there and just like poke the needle into the fabric and then take it out, poke it in, and do that about 5 or 6 times before I'm sure it's in the right spot.
It's fun learning.
Good times, good times.
It is good times.
It is relaxing, though.
It is, yes. Well, for my cosplay updates, I actually have it right behind me. You can see it. I actually moved it into frame this time. Yay! My backpack is officially done. The zipper is installed. It is fully functional and ready to go. It's actually quite stable for keeping it as a softy backpack. Like, you can still see the shape very nicely with this. It looks cute, and I appreciate it. So I'm enjoying it immensely. Only thing I have left to do is to figure out what's going on with the wig. I thought I liked the direction I was going in. Then I decided I didn't like the direction I was going in. And the next day I was like, no, I want to do it. And the next day after that, I was like, nah, I really don't want to do it. So I don't know what I'm doing. The only thing I know for certain is the cut that I gave the wig initially, I still really enjoy it. And it's going to stay that way, so that's cool. But I did restraighten it because I was like, the curls are a little too much at the bottom, so that's fine. It may even just stay that way, too, because it just looks so cute on its own that I probably don't really need to do much with it other than just to fiddle with the bangs and call it a day. I don't even know if I'm going to do the ears anymore. I don't know. It kind of changes day by day. I'm just letting the wig sit on a wig head, and I'm just putting pieces on it here and there, being like, you know, temporary piece, poop, do I like this? Let it leave the room, come back, and then I'm like, nah, throw it off, then try again.
I have this image in my head of doing the ears on a headband, mm-hmm. and then having a little, like, Venusaur flower-like lotus fascinator on the side, like a Hello Kitty kind of.
Honestly, that's been going through my head too, because I still have a bunch of headbands from a previous project that right. I could easily morph and manipulate to fit the wig color, so that way it can blend in a little bit better. Like I said, this is just a weird project at this point, where it's like I figured out everything beforehand except for the wig. That's the one piece that it's just like it's morphing and changing every day, and at some point it will be complete, but at least the garment is done. I have leggings for it. I have shoes for it. Like, all the rest of it is completely done. It's just, I don't know a single thing about the wig anymore. It will just morph into a thing when I'm ready to get it to morph. Other than
literally,
that.
Literally, yeah. You will use an evolution stone.
Yeah, literally I will use an evolution stone so that way it will transform into whatever the final form will be.
Just means you'll have a multi-accessory kit. Where you just choose whichever one you feel like having that day.
Maybe that's what I'll do. That's not a bad idea, actually. Maybe just have a couple different options and be like, okay.
Exactly.
I wake up and I know I'm going to wear this. What thing is going to go on my head today?
What do I feel like doing today? And you had something picked out last night and you wake up and you're like, oh, I don't feel like that anymore. And you just pick something else.
I just pick up the next thing. Like, here's the headband. Uh-huh. Pfft, done. Uh-huh. That may not be a bad idea at this point, because I'm just so indecisive on how this thing is going to get completed. But at least the outfit itself is done, and it's ready to go. And I have a cute bag. So yay! A bag of holding. Very important. But other than that, I've just been going through my fabric stash and making myself a bunch of work shirts. And I gotta pull out some other fabric pieces to start working on whatever the next cosplay will be. I've been in a sewing mode, so that's good. I've been enjoying it. I've just been making all the things, but now it's like, okay.
Air conditioner.
That helps. That helps out a ton. Some point, this will have to get stored so I can start working on the next project. So I got a bag ready to go, and it'll be sad to see this go away because it's been really nice having it grace my dress form in such a loving manner. Because it's so pretty. But when I wear it, I don't know either.
Yeah, unfortunately, we don't have any plans to go to conventions this year.
No.
I'm still, you know, a little regretful, but it's better for my health at this point to not go. So I wish those who are going, I know Project Akon is coming up, so I wish you guys a ton of fun and a safe, healthy time.
Yeah, unfortunately, I know too many people who have been going, and some of them have been getting sick, so I'm like, you're just confirming that I'm not going to go, and that's okay.
Just means we'll have awesome cosplays for next year.
Exactly. There you go. There's all my cosplay updates.
All right. Well, in that case, shall we move on to today's topic?
Yeah, let's go to move on to today's topic. I am finally going to unveil to you all the amazing zipper tutorial that I have been promising for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. We are finally at a point in this cycle of our season that I can bequeath it unto our viewers.
Unto you.
Unto you, our viewers and listeners. So I hope you guys enjoy this super easy, wonderful, magnificent zipper tutorial that will change your life forever. Enjoy!
We are going to show you an easy way to install zippers that will change your crafting life forever, or at least make the zipper process less of a headache. This is a simple tutorial that you can use on any zipper type for all garments. Here is what you will need: fabric, a zipper, thread, measuring tape, painter's tape or packing tape, it's preferred over pins, an iron for pressing, and your sewing machine. A zipper foot and a seam ripper are recommended, but optional. First, you'll want to measure out the distance of your zipper between the teeth and the edge. This will be your seam allowance. Most zippers are at a 5/8 inch, but it helps to double check. Then, using a pin or tailor's chalk, lay down your zipper and mark on the fabric where the zipper will end. You'll be sewing the fabric together with a straight stitch, a normal straight stitch on the bottom up to the pin line, then a long running stitch on the top to close the seam. Take the fabric to the sewing machine and make sure that your stitch length is set to a normal stitch. You're going to backstitch the bottom line for stability and durability. Then for the top half, you want to crank your stitch length to the longest setting possible to create the top part of the seam. This is going to be a running stitch. After this, flip the fabric so the seam is facing the wrong side up and press it down with an iron. You want the seam edges to open up on both sides. Then position the zipper. Flip it so the pull tab is facing down and away from you as we are working on the back side of the fabric. Make sure that the zipper teeth are right in the middle of the running stitch seam and the bottom of the zipper matches where you originally marked with the pin. The next part is to tape down the zipper in place. Sewing machines can run easily through painter's tape, masking tape, or packing tape without gunking up the needle. These tapes are also safe to use on virtually every fabric without leaving any residue behind. Do not use stronger tapes like duct tape. Those will destroy your needle and make a mess of your fabric. You can use sewing pins if you'd like, but the tape covers more area and helps keep the zipper and fabric flat. When done, we're back to the machine. This is where you should swap to a zipper foot if you'd like. The zipper will align nicely to match to the foot so it's easier to sew. Use a straight stitch at a normal stitch length to sew the zipper in. You may need to start and stop at the ends to adjust for the zipper pull and the metal teeth. I had to hand crank at the bottom of the step because I was using a metal zipper and I didn't want to break my needle. To help with the zipper pull, use a seam ripper to carefully remove some of the running stitches and move it down a few notches before returning to the machine to sew up the last bits. When done, remove the tape from the back. Flip the fabric over and use a seam ripper to remove the running stitch all the way down and clean up any stray threads. With that, you're done! You have now installed the zipper into your garment in an easy, less fussy method.
Hope you guys enjoyed that really easy tutorial that I had no idea was a thing. And when I read comments about it from a couple of people, they're like, oh yeah, my mom taught me this. Oh yeah, so-and-so taught me this. But most people were like, this is the most genius thing ever. Because I've never been taught how to install a zipper this method. So I'm like, I'm going to do this every time, all the time.
They're like those life hacks that you see in YouTube, right? Or TikTok videos where you're like, that's really clever.
Yep.
See, the problem with all of this knowledge is that it's only bequeathed unto certain people from their mothers or their relatives, or, you know, maybe a brother-in-law that sews, and it's passed down like through that, families.
Yeah.
But then it's not shared with the wider world, so the rest of us don't know that these wonderful things exist. And we need you guys to share this lovely, clever, magnificent knowledge with the rest of us so that we too can pass it on to other people.
Because I had no clue. I've been through professional sewing courses and they didn't teach me any of this stuff. So it's just like, thank you, internet.
They'll teach you the formal established way of doing these techniques,
which is awful.
Couture will teach you the same thing. There are very established ways of doing it, and if you deviate at all from any of these very formal techniques, you're considered a rebel,
yep,
and an outcast. But sometimes rebelling is an awesome thing, because then you find life hacks.
I know, make
it easier.
Yeah, I know easier ways to install sleeves now that since I've learned how to do it, I have not installed a sleeve incorrectly ever since, and that was always my biggest issue. And now that I know how to do zippers this way, it's like, wow. It's going to save me a tremendous number of hours, because literally zippers will take me hours to get correctly because I'm so picky about everything lining up just perfectly. Has to be this, has to be this, has to be this. And I try to do it the traditional way, and it just takes forever. Mm-hmm. I hate it.
It took me years to learn that the short end of the sleeve goes in the front.
Yes.
For the sleeve cap, if you ever look at a sleeve cap, they're not symmetric.
They're not symmetric.
They're not the same on both sides. One side is a shorter distance, and the other side is a slightly longer distance. And the longer one goes
in the back.
And that's how you know which sleeve is which. And it took me years to learn that, because nobody ever explained.
No one explains this.
That sleeve caps are not symmetric. Because even when I drafted my own patterns, I would always draft it symmetric. And it's like, no, no. So when you learn these things, please share with the class so that the rest of us don't take years to learn it too.
We would like to know. We're all about open learning here.
I mean, we'll happily share what we learn too.
Yeah. That's why we have a huge tutorial list on our YouTube. Yes.
That's why we've literally got 10 years worth of podcasts for you guys to go and listen to, where you can learn from us, from our mistakes.
There you go.
And our successes, for that matter.
Exactly.
All right. Well, of course, if you would like to join in the conversation and share your favorite life hack techniques where it comes to cosplay, sewing, makeup, wig work, anything that belongs in cosplay, feel free to share it with us via any of our social media, which of course you can find here.
For those who are watching us, all the information is located right underneath Amber over there. For those who are listening, visit us at cospod.org, on Facebook or Instagram at Cosplay Podcast, or on YouTube and Twitter at CosPodcast.
Or of course, if you would like to let us know what role you think Nick Cage should play in the upcoming Spirit Halloween movie, feel free to email us, podcast@cospod.org, where you will get an answer from each one of us, probably with at least one Nick Cage meme. Maybe Easter themed.
My folder is getting smaller, so I have to replenish it.
Yep. It will be a good excuse.
There you go.
Otherwise, we will wish you guys once more happy Easter, a blessed Good Friday, happy cosplaying. Please keep working on those costumes so that we can all dress up and meet up again at our favorite local convention sooner rather than later. Stay healthy, stay safe out there. Happy cosplaying, everybody. See you next time.
Bye, guys.